Okay, so now we'll be discussing application number two, that is determination of specific cell types. Whenever we are talking about specific cell types, there may be many types of samples. Okay, but right now we'll be discussing about, suppose, bone marrow. Okay, now when we talk about bone marrow, you should understand that bone marrow is actually a very good, you know, sample for T helper type 1, T helper type 2, and double positive cells and double negative cells. Now you should understand one thing, how we can actually, you know, specify that which one is T helper type 1, which one is T helper type 2, double negative, double positive cells, using flow cytometry, by, you know, doing one, you know, tricky thing that is known as cloning. Okay, now from where does cloning come in this particular section? Now listen, suppose if I tell you that this is T helper type 1 cell, then it will be CD8 positive cell. Okay, now if I tell you that this is T helper type 2, then this is CD4 positive cell. Now listen, there may be some cells which has got CD4 antigen, CD4 antigen, CD4 antigen, CD4 antigen, CD4 antigen, and also, sorry, CD8 antigen and CD4. Those antigens, those cells which have got both CD8 and CD4 positive cells are called double positive cells, right? Those are called double positive cells. Okay, now you should understand now one thing, that there are also some cells in our blood, in our, you know, bone marrow blood, that which are double negative. That means they don't have either CD8 positive or CD4 positive cells, right? Now we will, what we will have to do is, we will have to, you know, target some, now we will have to target, you know, specific antibodies against the CD8 and CD4 antigens. Now these antibodies are monoclonal antibodies, monoclonal antibody, and these antibodies, listen, the antibodies which will be attached to, antibodies which will be attached to these antigens, they are always monoclonal, always monoclonal. Okay, one, this is the first information you should have, that is those antigens which we will attach to these CD4 and CD8, you know, antigens, those antibodies, sorry, which will attach to CD4 and CD8 antigens will be a monoclonal antibodies, number one. And number two is very important point to understand, is these antibodies are attached with fluorescent protein or particles. Okay, now whenever we are talking about fluorescent particles, you should understand, whenever we are talking about fluorescent particles or protein, at least these names should come into your mind, that is FITC and Texas Red. Okay, now you should understand one thing, FITC stands for fluorescein isothiocyanate. FITC stands for fluorescein isothiocyanate, that is FITC. Okay, and Texas Red also has a, you know, big name, which is known as, which is also called actually sulforhodamine acid chloride. Okay, the full name of this Texas Red is sulforhodamine acid chloride. Okay, actually between sulfurodamine and acid chloride there is 101. Okay, so this is the full form of Texas red. Now listen, whenever we are talking about these two things, you should understand that fluorescein is a protein. Listen with all your attention. Fluorescein is a protein, and sulfurodamine 101, that is rhodamine, is the actual dye. It's not a protein, it's a dye, means it's a particle. It's a particle, and when it is excited, it will emit red light. Rhodamine, this R stands for red. Okay, this R stands for red. This R stands for red. That means whenever we talk about fluorescent proteins or fluorescent particle, two things should come into your mind. One, that is FITC, fluorescein, isothiocyanate, and Texas red, sulfurodamine 101, acid chloride. Now listen with all your attention. This is not a protein. Rhodamine is not a protein. Okay, it's a compound. But listen, fluorescein is a protein. But this protein has got many disadvantages as well. Okay, that means, suppose this is an antibody, okay? And this is FC portion, right? This is FC portion. Now, if you want to attach, suppose this is your antibody, suppose this is your antibody, and if you want to attach FITC, suppose you want to attach here FITC, the problem will be FITC being a protein, okay, FITC being a protein will never, you know, interact with this protein. And this actually is the, you know, drawback of fluorescein itself. That's why scientists have added an additional group to this fluorescent protein, that is isothiocyanate. And due to this isothiocyanate, this, you know, every protein has got NH2, you know, right? NH2 and COOH part, right? N-terminal and C-terminal. Every protein has got N-terminal and C-terminal. Now listen. This isothiocyanate actually interacts with this amino terminal or sulfhydryl terminal, and they actually gets bound to this protein, right? That means what I am saying is, to this N-terminal, isothiocyanate ITC is actually attached, and to ITC fluorescein is actually attached. That means now what we will get is, suppose this is your antibody and this is FC portion and this is NH2. To this NH2 actually we are attaching ITC, isothiocyanate, and to this isothiocyanate what is attached? Fluorescein, a protein. That means now this antibody as a whole will emit green fluorescence when it is excited. Okay, now this antibody will now emit green fluorescence. Okay, now Texas red. Now listen, you should understand one thing. When we will talking about, you know, fluorescence microscopy, then you will understand what is the meaning of the term fluorescence. Fluorescence, do you know what is the meaning of the term fluorescence? Fluorescence means a particular thing is capturing, suppose a wavelength of light, suppose 400 nanometer of light, and it is giving out 600 nanometer of light. That means a particle which is capturing light at a lower wavelength but giving out light at higher wavelength. Now you should understand one thing, FITC also captures light. This is very, you know, intricate details right now. Okay, FITC captures light in the blue region, but it gives out light at green region at higher wavelength, almost 630 nanometer of wavelength. It captures light only at 530 nanometers, but it gives out light at 630. This is called fluorescence. More, you know, energetic pulses of light rays are given out. Only some of the, you know, proteins and some of the, you know, particles in our whole world has this capability of fluorescence. Not all your planes are fluorescent, you know, labeled, right? You use some pens which are fluorescently labeled, right? The sparkle, you know, right? Why? I can tell you right now, I have these type of pens right now. These are the pens which are called highlighters, right? These are the pens which are called highlighters, and they are what? They're fluorescently, they have got fluorescent labeled particles in them, do one thing today. Apply this fluorescently labeled, you know, dye in your white, you know, paper. It will fluoresce, right? Apply it in any other surface which is blackish. Will it give any light? Why, you know? Because light is falling on it, no problem. But when you are applying it on a black surface, black absorbs all the light. That is the problem. It is giving light, don't worry, but black again is absorbing it. But when you apply it on a white surface, okay, it is giving out light, and that light is actually not captured by the surface itself. Okay, now listen. We will talk about fluorescence, and we will talk about obviously Einstein's theory in details later, because this is actually the place where you should know what is the basic physics of these fluorescent particles. Okay, we will talk about fluorescent microscope in great details. Now, you should understand one thing, that how these things will help us in determining how many TH1, how many TH2, how many double positive or double negative cells are there in a sample. Now let us actually, you know, experiment with a sample which contains a mixture of this TH1, TH2, double positive, double negative cells, and let us, you know, on our virtual flow cytometer, and let's see what happens in the computer screen. Now listen,